Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your favorite, absolutely favorite brother from another mother coming to you guys via on demand YouTube from St. Paul, Minnesota, White Bear Lake to be exact. God bless you guys. Hope you're all doing all right today. I just wanted to come on here and give you a praise report. Hallelujah. I think we had five or six people baptized up here, and several more also besides those prayed for. Just got finished doing a for the Lord, just got through being used by the Lord to be part of the Lord's work for a deliverance from alcohol addiction and salvation. I want to thank the Lord for that. The Lord moved mightily. I just want to thank the Lord. He moved mightily. Even through, it was through Skype, brothers and sisters. And the Lord moved mightily. I asked you guys to pray for our brother John, who I just got through praying with for deliverance from alcohol and salvation. And through Skype. And praise God, the Lord moved mightily. And I know that he's delivered. And now he has baby steps to take to total restoration of his life. And I ask you guys to pray for that, because Jesus said, the enemy has come to kill, steal, and destroy, but I have come that you might have life and life to the fullest. And so, God's will is to give us a blessed life, brothers and sisters, and to walk in his glory and walk in his light and be salt and light for him. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to say this. There are people in this world who have been called to be martyrs for the Lord. Now, we know that. But the attitude that lots of these old religious people have, they try to put that old attitude, if God wants to kill you so you can make it to heaven, attitude like the people that that are post-tribbers, they seem to delight in the suffering of Christians and talk about Christian suffering. And there are times when God has allowed people to be fed to the lions and killed even today, like with the ISIS and all that, killing those Coptic Christians and all those things. God allowed those things, but God's will, God's perfect will, as Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. He said the enemy, John chapter 10, the enemy has come to kill, steal, and destroy. God is not killing these people. The devil's killing them. God is allowing that for his glory. For it says in Romans 8:28, all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purposes. So sometimes it brings glory to God when the enemy is trying to kill people, and then sometimes God will allow that to happen if someone's being killed in the name of the Lord, like what happened with ISIS killing these Coptic Christians and things like that. That's not God's will, but he allows that. It brings glory to his name, brothers and sisters. But God's intention is none to perish. All come to repentance. As Jesus said, John chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, the enemy comes not but to kill, steal, and destroy. God's not killing the people. God's not putting sickness on people. God allowed that. Just like with the story of Job. Go back, Job settles that right there. The oldest book in the Bible that we have is the book of Job. Just a FYI. The oldest book in the New Testament is James, FYI. So, brothers and sisters, God's intention is for us to have life abundantly. As Jesus said, the text is not in front of me. I had no idea the Lord was going to give me this message. But in that John 10, 9 and 10, Jesus said, the enemy comes not but to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come that you may have life, and life to the fullest, or life in abundance. That's in this life and the life to come. Because one time when the apostles were following Jesus, Peter, is famous for saying those kind of things. He said to Jesus, we've given up everything to follow you, Lord. What is in it for us? What's going to be there for us? And Jesus said, there will be, houses, and blessings and abundance in this life and in the life to come and in heaven with persecution. Jesus added that caveat, with persecution. So we Christians are to be persecuted by the world. Jesus said, they hated me. No, they'll hate you also. No servant is above his master. They hated me. They'll hate you also. So we know that we have persecution from the devil and from his people and from this world and everything that's anti-Christ. As John tells us, people keep talking about the Antichrist, but the whole world is Antichrist. The world is Antichrist. Don't you know that the world killed Jesus? God allowed that to happen. God knew that was going to happen, but the world killed Jesus. The world thought it was doing its own will, mankind, when they killed Jesus. But that was God's plan from the beginning. He spoiled principalities, as it says in Colossians. He spoiled principalities and made a show of them openly triumphing over them in it, the Bible says. Hallelujah. God made a show of them. He spoiled their power and authority by what they thought was a victory by killing Jesus. But was actually a victory for us. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. And the Lord has an abundant life, as he told his disciples. I give you, you know, you'll have houses and all these abundant things, and this life and in the world to come, with persecution. So God blesses his people, even as Jesus talks about. You know, give, Luke chapter 7, you know, get off of this, you know, copy and paste idea, you know, we're not, you know, just, you know, oh, you're prosperity, or oh, you're Calvinist. No, I'm as prosperity as the Bible is prosperity. I'm as we need to be, you know, poor as much as the Bible is we're near to be poor. I'm as Calvinist as the Bible is Calvinist, and I'm as free will as the Bible is free will, or Arminianism. You know, I'm just as Arminian as the Bible is, and I'm just as Calvinist as the Bible is. You know, people put these religion cookie cutters on you. Don't let people put religious doctrinal boundaries and cookie cutters on you. I'm a truth seeker and a follower of Christ, whatever that may be. I'm a truth seeker and a follower of Christ. And Jesus said in Luke chapter 7, give and it'll be given unto you in good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure you measure, it'll be measured back to you. Now Jesus used this saying. This is the standard and the way God operates. Just like he says, you reap what you sow. You know, God is not mocked. Whatever a man soweth, he shall reap. If you sow, reap to the spiritual, if you sow the spirit, you'll reap of the spirit. If you sow the flesh, you'll reap corruption. You'll reap a whirlwind. That's why, you know, the Lord is telling us these things. Just like about judging in Matthew chapter 7. To say Luke 7 for giving, then Matthew chapter 7, judging. Judge not, lest you shall be judged, Jesus said. For the same measure you use to judge, it'll be measured back to you. That's why it's really sad and laughable of all the, you know, self-righteous hypocrite trolls and people like that, you know, religious people that you run into, because they're using this measure to judge other people when they themselves are going to be measured by that same measure. Brothers and sisters, I need all the grace I can get. I need all the mercy I can get. I need all the love I can get. I need all the blessings I can get. So I'm going to sow those things. Hallelujah. I'm going to sow grace and mercy and kindness and patience to other people because that's what I need. Amen. I need God to give that to me. I don't want to have this old religious, self-righteous, you know, Pharisee spirit and vessel that I use to measure other people and judge other people, because it's going to be measured back to me. So I want to give grace because I need all I can get, brothers and sisters. And the same thing is true. It's not about no, you know, this prosperity gospel that God wants you to have a gold-plated Cadillac. But Jesus said, if you give, it'll be given unto you. That's everything. Give out of the goodness of your heart and the abundance of your heart. God will bless you back with whatever you need. That's why I tell people, that's God's principle. If you have relatives that are not saved, I said this before, and I always have this one person always tries to stand against every truth that I speak from God. And I've wasted, you know, when I was new on YouTube, I would waste my time trying to deal with that person. I don't deal with those type of people anymore. This is a truth of just what I've been just saying. If you have relatives that are not saved, stop focusing on them and go win somebody else's relatives to the Lord. You know, go sow what you need to reap. You need evangelism in your family, go sow evangelism in somebody else's family. That's how God operates, as I told you. It's joy. Jesus first, others second, yourself last. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount again from Matthew 5, 6, and 7, he said, you know, even the heathen or even the pagans greet their own relatives and are nice to their own relatives. You know, that's why Jesus said, bless those that curse you. You know, you're supposed to be good to those strangers and people that can never repay us. That's what, you know, these are basic principles of the Bible, brothers and sisters. So that's why if you would read your Bible and get it in your spirit, then when people come up with all kinds of wacky stuff, they're going up against what the principles that the Lord Jesus Christ himself laid out. To put Jesus first, others second, yourself last, including your own thing, your own relatives. That's why Jesus said in that same text, in the Sermon on the Mount, when you have a feast, don't invite rich people, because you know they can invite you to their feast. They can return the favor. See, that's not giving. That's what they call in the Philippines in Spanish, por favor. You know, you do a favor. It's not a gift. I used to talk about this all the time before. They're not giving, but doing a favor. That's not grace. That's not giving. That's a favor. But Jesus said, when you have a feast, instead of inviting rich people, invite the poor, the maimed, the halt, you know, the handicapped, all these kind of people, sick people, who can never repay you. And then God, who sees in heaven, will be the one to reward you. Now, the problem with people, they live in a paradigm of, you know, of the flesh. In a paradigm of not being able to, you know, thinking with man's mind, and not the Bible says we're supposed to have the mind of Christ. You can take what I just quoted from the Lord and apply that to everything. When you give, Jesus said, expect nothing in return. That's in all things. But God will reward you. God will reward you. How does he reward you? Anyway, Jesus also said in Luke 7, as I just quoted, giving will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will men give into your bosom. So God will use other people to bless you. As I said, your relatives are lost, you go evangelize somebody else. God will send a man or a woman, a person to your family, your relatives, to evangelize them. You have financial trouble, you know, you need a better job, you can also give, and God will give to you, but not only for that reason. Not only for that reason, just for something in return. We give as unto the Lord, and God will bless us. There's a difference there, brothers and sisters. A difference. We're doing it, number one, to be obedient to the Lord. We love the Lord. Just like evangelizing, I mentioned about your relatives. Your family needs to be saved, so you go evangelize somebody else. That's true, because that's how God operates. We reap what we sow. But the number one reason, because I want to add this disclaimer on here, this caveat on here. When you're going to go evangelize, brothers and sisters, we do it because Jesus said, go ye into all the nations, you know, and make disciples of the nation, and then baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. We're supposed to be making disciples. We're supposed to go share the gospel, spread the gospel. All Christians are called to do that. Not all Christians are called to have evangelism crusades, but all Christians are called to be a witness, to tell of the hope that lies within us. So brothers and sisters, the number one reason why we evangelize or give financially to ministries, give our time to pray with people, visit people in the hospital, in prison, all those things. Jesus said, when you visit somebody in prison, Matthew chapter 25, when you give food to the poor, when you go evangelize somebody, all that, you've done it unto me. Jesus said in this exact example I'm giving in Matthew chapter 25, when you've done it to the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. And when you have not done it to the least of these, my brethren, you have not done it unto me. So when you go and do any of those things in the name of the Lord, you're doing it as unto the Lord himself. That's where people can't get it. You know, just you talk, especially the number one problem that most people have is about giving money. And they always make excuses about all this, all about these ministries, all this stuff. When you give, you're giving unto the Lord. When you give to, or you know, you could go downtown where you live at, get some cans of soup or whatever, cans of beanie weenies or Spam, and you go down there and you give it to some poor person, some homeless person, and say, I'm giving you this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me pray for you. Have you invited Jesus Christ into your heart or whatever? You know, evangelize them, witness to them, talk to them about the Lord Jesus. That's doing as it unto the Lord. Go to the prison and visit people and pray for them. Write them letters. Give letters from them to their family, whatever, those kind of things that you might do. You know, go give, buy Christmas presents for children of people that are in prison, like the ministry there of the late Chuck. What's his name? Used to work for, was in jail. Watergate scandal. started this, the prison ministry for the children of prisoners. Whatever you do in the name of the Lord, even as Jesus said, he who gives a cup of cold water to a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. And I just, I just think about, because look, brothers and sisters, there's no need to preach it to the choir, okay? So, I always try to stay positive, but I can't just keep preaching to the choir. Those who would attack and mock and make trouble for this, thank the Lord I don't have many. But there are people who try to make trouble for me, and I'm sure they do it to other pastors. And there are people that give pastors a hard time under the guise of being a Christian. I pray for those people, who are trying to be thorns and stumbling blocks, especially to the servants of God. I ask you guys to pray in agreement with me for them. Of course, what the Bible says, you reap what you sow. They're playing with fire. They're playing with God. Jesus said, what you've done to the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. Now, I pray that even though your ears be filled with the voices of demons, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that God would open your ears, that you might have an ear to hear what the Spirit of the Most High God says to this world. Repent, therefore, and be thou delivered, be thou saved. Be saved from the fiery pit of hell. Repent of your wicked ways. For what you've done to the least of God's children, you've done it unto me, Jesus said. I pray for the repentance of those people. Brothers and sisters, God bless you. I try to stay positive, but you can't be Joel Osteen and you can't be, begging all the time. We can't go around to please people, but to please God. And so, brothers and sisters, that's, me, those of you watching my videos, that's what I'm all about. Pleasing God. One man audience, the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise his holy name. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just want to get on here and tell you guys that I love all of you guys, and I've had an awesome time here in Minneapolis meeting all the brothers and sisters, and meeting some great brothers and sisters in Chicago. And I thank the Lord for the people that were able to be baptized also in Chicago. And I'll be back in Chicago again tomorrow night, and I'm supposed to have one baptism, and I'm waiting on confirmation back from them. I just want to say this, that like the people I'm going to be meeting in Petersburg and other places, I'm going to have to, have a better system. I've got to have a better system of people RSVPing with me. I need people to RSVP me to reach out to me, because I'm busy talking to all the people. I can't, remembering to message everybody. I need people to message me, because I'm only one person. And I'm always, as a servant of the Lord, I bend over backwards to try to contact people and all that who said they wanted to meet me. But brothers and sisters, I can only do so much. So people are going to have to contact me and be responsible for getting in touch with me, brothers and sisters, in the future. So I love you guys. I appreciate all of you guys. I thank all of the people that met with me and got to be baptized on. I really appreciate it. I really enjoyed it. And I met some true brothers and sisters in Christ who now that I've met them, I really know them and love them in the Lord. When I first came to the States and got started out, I ran into a little bit of, if you guys have been watching my videos, a little bit of wackiness. Thank God, I've been able to, the Lord has, I prayed about it, and the Lord has put lots of great brothers and sisters in Christ in my path to be able to minister to, So I thank the Lord for that, because when I meet with people, I'm a pastor. I have a prophetic ministry. I'm a servant of God. I'm here to minister to people, and I have no time for any kind of foolishness or those kind of things. As I've talked about in my videos before, brothers and sisters, I have people that wanted to meet with me, and they're trying to preach to me and teach me. Before in Louisiana, I had that, and also in the first time I went to Raleigh or Greensboro, I met with a bunch of people from Raleigh. Had people trying to tell me. And preach to me, take authority, you know, take control over the work of the Lord. So I thank the Lord that the time now that I've been in the States, by the grace of God, I've received experience and wisdom and all those things. And then the Lord has just been sending some really, really great brothers and sisters to meet with me. So I'm really happy and personally happy and pleased with the brothers and sisters that I've met. It was worth all the travel to meet the people in Chicago and in Minneapolis and other places. And even now, tomorrow, I'll be meeting somebody in Wisconsin, border area. So thank God for that. I'll be passing through Wisconsin tomorrow, and I'll be meeting some people along the highway there in Wisconsin. So if you watch this video, you're watching this long, you try to meet me, contact me. I'll let you know the place. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless. And I'll be back again in Chicago tomorrow night. If anybody else needs to be baptized in the Chicago area, tomorrow night's the last chance to... for it to be me to be the one to baptize you or pray with you. God bless you guys. Praise God. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God all day long. Give him all the glory, brothers and sisters. Give him the glory. God bless.